after I met the Lord in my apartment, a young Italian guy named Vince asked me to help him move. He was a friend of, a boyfriend of somebody who worked with Heather, that Heather knew, or a friend of Heather somehow. And so I went to Vince's house to help him move. I didn't know him, he didn't know me. And as I'm helping him move, I find out that his Bible has been marked up. He's got a Bible that's a modern looking Bible. It's got pictures in it. It doesn't look like the black leather bound, red sided Bible. But not only that, I happened to pick it up to pack it, to move it. And he's got it underlined and highlighted. It shocked me. And so I'm standing there looking at, I'd never seen a Bible marked up before. I'd never seen anyone write in a Bible before, other than, you know, births and deaths on the first page. And so I'm looking at, he's embarrassed. He finds me looking at his Bible. I said, no, this is cool. I've never seen anyone do this to their Bible. I said, man, you're taking this serious. And he was embarrassed by that. And we got talking about it, and he said, you know, I'm a believer. I said, I'm a believer. And it's not just a song, it's I'm a believer. And so I hadn't been to church yet, hadn't been baptized in water. He's the first Christian that I'm meeting. And he's Catholic, but he's a genuine Christian, and that kind of surprised me. And then I found out, I was talking to my sister, who's a couple years older than me, come to find out she met the Lord, and her husband met the Lord, and that completely surprised me. We weren't raised in a Christian home, in a typical Christian home, and so for my sister to tell me that she believes in Jesus, and she's asked Jesus to come in her heart, that was a real surprise to me. And my brother-in-law, I don't know how he knew this, he said, there's a meeting that you have to get to. And I've looked it up. There's no internet back then, so I don't know how he found this out. He said, there's a meeting Saturday morning in a town near you, and you gotta get to that meeting. And he tried to explain what it was about. I couldn't understand anything that he was saying, but he said, you gotta get to this meeting. So I called Vince and I said, there's a meeting on Saturday morning. Do you wanna go with me? And I must not have had wheels at that time, I'm not sure. But anyway, Vince agreed to go with me. We went to the meeting. It was in a hotel, in the basement of a hotel, or a big ballroom of a hotel. It was called Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship International. And my brother-in-law was trying to tell me that. I couldn't get any of that. He said, never mind, I'll give you the address and you go. So Vince and I are there. There's a speaker, it's packed. The place is packed, Saturday morning, and they're worshiping, and we'd never seen that before. And then the speaker gets up, and he's a ball of fire, and he's talking about miracles and healings and angels visiting him and visions that he's had. And next thing you know, he starts pointing at people and speaking to them prophetically. And there's a guy right beside me that he points to from the front, and he speaks to him a prophecy. So we're hearing prophecy for the first time. He's speaking in tongues. Vince and I had never heard or seen any of this before. The only thing I knew about tongues was that my sister, as a young girl, had decided to read the Bible on her own. She had gotten the Bible. I don't know where she found the Bible. But she was determined to read the entire Bible on her own. And so she got through it, and a pastor, a relative of ours who was a pastor, came to visit us. And while he was there, she said, I've got questions. I've been reading the Bible, and there's a lot of things I don't understand. Can you answer my questions? And he agreed to do this. And I happened to be sitting in a little side room. I could hear them but not see them. And my sister's asking, you know, did Adam and Eve have belly buttons? Which is a great question to think about. She's got, you know, who did Adam and Eve's sons marry? Well, they married their sisters. but that was before the law. It wasn't forbidden. And so anyway, he's answering all her questions. And one of her questions was, have you ever heard anyone speak in tongues? And he kind of dismissed her and dismissed it by saying, no, it's not for today. And she said, but it's in the Bible. And he said, yeah, but it's passed away. Nobody speaks in tongues today. It doesn't happen. It's not for today. And she raised her little voice, speaking to this grown man, a pastor, and she said, but it's in the Bible. And he dismissed it again, and she said, but it's in the Bible. I'm in the other room, and so all I know about tongues is it's in the Bible. I don't know anything about it. Now this man, this speaker at this conference meeting, is speaking in tongues. And he's praying for the sick. People are falling down by the power of the Spirit. They're falling down, not just one or two, like sometimes whole groups of people are falling down. We're watching this. We've never been in a meeting like this. This is our first meeting. I haven't even been to church yet. Vince is a good Catholic. He's been in church, but they don't do this in his church. And Vince says to me, I got to see what this is all about. I'm going up there. I said, no, if you go up there, that might happen to you. He said, I gotta see this. So Vince walks to the front, and I'm watching the back of his head, and he gets up to where the speaker is, and all of a sudden he disappears. He fell down. He comes back to me, he's staggering, he's wide-eyed. This happened to him. He's in shock. And then demons started screeching and calling out. One guy standing just, you know, 10 feet away from me. It looks like unseen hands are around his neck and are strangling him. And I'm watching this, and he's powerless to stop it, to do anything about it. He's gurgling and gasping, and he can hardly breathe. He's being choked. And it just came out of me. I just said, in the name of Jesus, come out. I don't even know how I knew that. Other people started doing it. We all started doing it. Next thing you know, the man collapsed and was set free, but you could tell he was embarrassed. He didn't know what happened to him. And then across the room, another woman began to screech the same way. So Vince and I are driving home, and it's a very quiet drive. We're not talking. We're in shock. We'd never seen anything like it. And finally, you know, he dropped me off and see you later, Vince. So I'm reading the Bible like Vince. I'm starting to mark it out. I've got a Bible just like his. And I'm reading, and I come to Mark 16 in verse 17. This is just before Jesus leaves. And he says, these signs shall follow those who believe. He says, in my name, they will cast out demons, they will lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. It says in verse 17, and they shall speak with new tongues. Well, I read that, and this is Jesus speaking, and I'm realizing, oh, that's for believers. It's for believers who believe, and it's a sign. It was almost like, for the first time, I felt permission from Jesus to speak in tongues, permission from Jesus to pray for the sick and cast out demons, and like he wanted me to. It's like he wanted anyone who believed. It was like the best verse that I'd ever seen. Like it was really, I knew something about speaking in tongues by this time because I'd heard that guy speak in tongues. And it created a desire within me to speak in tongues. So I began to pray and ask the Lord for this experience, and began to read more about it. I had started reading the book of Acts, and I wanted the Holy Spirit. I wanted everything. But I didn't have a mentor. I didn't have a class like this. It wasn't something you talked about very much. Two things happened. I began pursuing this on my own and began praying for people on buses and trains and leading people to the Lord, casting out demons, praying for the sick. I just wanted to do all the stuff that Jesus was talking about here. And two things happened that were interesting during this early period. Vince said, I went to one of your meetings. Why don't you come to one of mine? Well, I grew up in a period in Canada where Catholics and Protestants hated each other. And I'd been abused by Catholics. Our neighborhood had a Catholic school, but the Catholics lived around my school. We had to cross paths every day, and we decimated their school and wrecked it and put out windows, and they did all kinds of nasty stuff to our school. And you had to go to school in a group because you'd get beat up if you're by yourself. And other than the nuns, there was a convent halfway between, and that was a safe zone. They wouldn't hurt you while the nuns were on the street. The nuns looked mean for the most part, except for one day, one nun, we saw a young nun come out of the convent, and her face glowed, and she looked like Jesus. I mean, she just was clothed with love. She looked at us with love. We were just always scanning the nuns to see if she was there, because she was one of the most beautiful people we'd ever seen. It was just, and she loved us, even though we were destined for hell. But according to the Catholics, they would remind us every day that we were going to hell. Unless you're Catholic, you went to hell. So I had all these aversions to being around Catholics, but I liked Vince, and he's saying, would you come to one of my Catholic meetings? He said, you're going to love this. And I'm thinking, I doubt it. You don't know what I've been through. They broke my brother's leg one day. We had all kinds of fights. I doubt I'm going to like your meeting, Vince, but I like you, so I'll go. I go to his meetings, and there's a nun there whose face radiates with the love of Jesus, and she looks at me like she loves me. And it melted my heart. Like I hadn't experienced that since I was a kid. And these meetings were about speaking in tongues and prophecy. It was a 7-week course called Life in the Spirit. And you'd sit around, there'd be a guy standing with a guitar, and they would they would play, and they'd all sing together just with this lone guitar. And then they would sing in tongues. And it was the most heavenly sound I've ever heard. One of the most beautiful, to this day, easily one of the most beautiful things I've ever heard. They would sing in tongues, and it would ascend and descend and then ascend. And they're just ordinary people, but it sounded like there were angels with us. It was amazing. And then when we finished that part, we'd all meet in little small groups, and we'd pray for each other to be able to speak in tongues and to prophesy. And I like these meetings. And the other thing that happened is I felt like the Lord was speaking to me. It was time for me to go to church. I told him I didn't want to go to church. I said, I like you, but I don't want to go to church. He said, it's in your best interest that you go. So I said, can you show me the church you go to? If you show me what church you go to, I'll go. Got in my car and started driving around the city, stopping in front of churches, waiting for him to tell me. I'd stop in front of a church, get nothing at all. Keep going, come to another church, keep going. Came to one church, it was very handsome and it was very prominently located, and I thought, I could be able to tell people that's my church, you know, everyone knows where it is. It's a very beautiful building. I went in and I asked the receptionist if I could speak to the pastor. She went to get him, and while I'm there, I just felt like this is wrong, this is not for me. I actually ran from the church back to my car. I often wonder what the secretary would have said to the pastor, but see me running away, running back to my car. I ran to my car not because I was afraid. I ran to my car because I felt like I had missed the Lord. And it just felt like a business. It just didn't feel right. And so I got back in my car, asked the Lord to forgive me, and began driving again. And then I got lost. I got up on a street that I'd never been on before. And as I'm passing this church, I just feel that's my church. I know that's my church. I did a U-turn, went back in, pulled in. The pastor just happened to be locking the door, and he's got a young disciple with him. And I run up the stairs, we talk, and I said, I'm looking for a church. And he said, I think you found it. And he said, come on in, I'll show you around. It's a brand new building that had just been built. And he showed me around, and I'm asking him a few questions. And I'm not sure what to ask him because I don't know any theology, but I want to, you know, is this legitimate? I don't want to get in a cult at this point in time. And I didn't know one church from another at that stage. And so I asked him a few questions. But just before I left, for some reason, I said, do you believe in speaking in tongues? And he kind of looked at me, and I know he was thinking, if I say yes, that he may leave. If I say no, he may leave. I don't know why this guy is asking this. It's kind of like a no-win situation. I don't know why I'm asking it either. So he said, finally, I could see him, his wheels were turning. Finally, he says, yes, we speak in tongues. We believe in speaking in tongues. And I said, good, because it's in the Bible. And so that was Friday. So that next Sunday, I went to church for the first time and had an amazing experience with the Lord. And then they offered baptism. So I got baptized. And so I'm going there, but I'm also going to Vince's meetings. And they're beginning to lay hands on people. And I'm seeking the Lord for speaking in tongues. I didn't know all about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I just wanted to speak in tongues. It's in the Bible. Jesus said it's available. So I'm seeking tongues and being prayed for in these Catholic meetings for prophecy and tongues, going to this Pentecostal church. But the Lord begins to work with me. And I'm not able to speak in tongues. And I conclude that he doesn't want me to have this ability. But the more I study the book of Acts, I see that they're all speaking in tongues. I begin to see that it's really about the Holy Spirit, not speaking in tongues, and I began to shift my focus. But every time I saw that they received the Holy Spirit, they spoke in tongues, and so I wanted the real deal. I wanted the real experience. I had no theology, no one to mentor me, no one to help me with this. I'm struggling, I'm on my own, and going to the Catholic meetings, they're talking about it, and I hear them singing in tongues, and I'm standing there, I can't join in. I join in with English, but I love what I'm hearing. I'm loving, and I love their humility, they're pursuing speaking in tongues and prophecy, and I feel safe there. I feel it's good people. Except it bothered me that, you know, we would do this and they'd go out for a cigarette break. And I'd been delivered from cigarettes. And so it just seemed odd. I wasn't able to fully understand all of that. But, and I'm seeking the Lord on my own. And I conclude that the reason that I'm not able to speak in tongues is God does want me to become proud. And I'm not mature enough. I don't know enough. I haven't read enough of the Bible. I haven't prayed enough. And so I'm trying to earn it by getting all my ducks in a row, by doing everything that I should be doing. And I got baptized in water and doing everything I know to do, trying to help the Lord to see that I would be a good candidate to get this, but he's withholding it. Because maybe there's some pride in my heart. And so I'm trying to empty the pride of my heart. I'm praying on my knees. I'm doing everything I can, and it's not working. Finally, I realized that as I'm studying the book of Acts, the places where they spoke in tongues, that it seemed like people laid hands on them for this experience, and I wasn't willing for that to happen, in part because I didn't want someone to see that I wasn't getting anywhere, and I didn't want them to know maybe there's sin in my life, maybe there's pride, and I don't want them to know that. And so then I realized, well, that's pride, that I don't want them to know that I have pride. And so I'm wrestling with this whole pride issue, which is, if you ever try to hit a bat, to get a bat out of your room, you know, it's really hard to do. And I'm trying to hit pride, really hard to do. The more pride you look for to get rid of, the more pride you see. And so finally I decided I would humble myself and I'd go to the Pentecostal church, and I would ask them, the first person I met, I was going to ask them to pray that I would be able to speak in tongues. So I went to church one day during the middle of the week. Happened to meet the assistant pastor. So I walked up to him and I said, Pastor, I want to speak in tongues. I want all that God has for me. And he seemed pleased. He seemed really delighted. And I'm thinking, well, you don't know how hard this has been. I've been doing this. I've been praying every day, missing meals. I've been perspiring, trying to get the ability to speak in tongues, and I have not got anywhere. He seemed like this was going to be nothing. This was going to be easy. Oh, well, that's wonderful. I'm so glad you want this. And yeah, I'm glad to pray for you. And I'm thinking, I'm a hard case. You don't know what you're getting into. I couldn't tell him that I was going to Catholic meetings because that was a no-no. So, but I wasn't getting any further in the Catholic meetings either. They were praying for me and I wasn't getting anywhere. So he put his hand on my back, and he raised the other hand, and he says, Father, thank you for Penn and his willingness to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. I'm praying, I pray, Lord, that you give him this experience now. He's just got his hand lightly on my back, and I'm already disappointed because I didn't want him to do this, but I thought he'd rough me up a little bit. I thought he'd put his hands on me and give me this Pentecostal massage. I didn't want that, but he's praying too easy. I mean, I've been really perspiring in prayer, and this guy is just praying a nice little prayer. God give Penn the Holy Spirit, help him to speak in tongues. And I'm thinking, man, that prayer is not going to get anywhere. I felt like saying, brother, you got to put yourself into this. You got to perspire a little bit, you know. Because I was trying to squeeze it out of me, and I couldn't get it out of me. So I thought, this little prayer is not going to do any good. And I didn't want him to rough me up, but then when he didn't, I was kind of disappointed. I thought, man, I've prayed harder than this. And so nothing happened, and I was disappointed that I put myself in that place of failure. And he's saying, Penn, are you feeling anything? Are you getting anything? And I said, not really. He said, I'll pray again. So again, he put his hand on my back, and he's praying. Now this whole other thing goes through my mind. I don't want him to be disappointed. He's sincerely praying. I mean, I could hear the sincerity of his heart. So I'm saying, oh, God, give it to me. I don't want him to be disappointed, you know. And as I'm standing there, and I finally believed, it was really the first time I believed I received, even though I didn't feel anything. I'd never gotten to that place before. So I said, I receive the Holy Spirit. I receive tongues, even though I hadn't had that ability. And something happened. A word came to my mind, and he must have felt me being jarred, and he must have realized that something happened. He said, what just happened? I said, I think I have a word. he said, speak it out loud. And I had to kind of find voice for it, like it's inside me, but you have to articulate it. And so I wanted to say it right, you know, and so I said, well, I think it's like Shanana. And he said, praise the Lord, that's wonderful. And he's happy and daubing his eyes, and I'm thinking, my first thought was, one word? Like, God doesn't trust me with more? Like, I wanted a fire hose kind of experience. I wanted a gush of a whole bunch of words. And I pictured that the Holy Spirit would be the one speaking through me, and there would be this fire hose experience, a torrent of words by the Spirit coming out of my mouth that I would have no control over. I didn't want that, but I thought that's what would happen. I was kind of braced against it because I thought, well, what if I'm in the supermarket and all of a sudden he gushes all these words out all in aisle four and I have no control over it. I didn't want that kind of experience. So I was kind of holding back, and he was just pleased. He said, praise the Lord, that's wonderful. And so he went his way and I went mine. I went, got out my car, and all of a sudden it hit me, Shanana. There was a rock band around that time that did 1950s Greece music, or early rock and roll. It was a Greece band called Shanana. And I thought, you fool, you just said that to get the pressure off the pastor praying for you, and you just pulled that out of your past. And I was just so disappointed with myself. I went home, I was so dejected, and went and lay down on the couch, put my hand over my eyes and said, oh God, help me. I just made that up. That was me saying Shanana. And I was so disappointed. And then there's a still small voice, just a quiet, calm voice that said, use what you have. I said, really? Just go ahead and say that, Shanana? Is that okay? Could I? And it really was the first moment that I realized that maybe I'm onto something. We lived near this park on Lake Ontario, and I would go there to pray. And so I would go to that green strip of park, and I would get out there, and I would pray like a house on fire. Father, I bless you, and I praise you, and I worship you. And then I'd say, Shanana. There, I'm using it. I'm using what I have. And then I would pray a bunch in English, and then I would stop, and I'd say, Shanana, Shanana, Shanana. And it didn't feel like anything. It didn't have any power, didn't change anything. And so I'd pray another 10 steps and another bunch of English prayers, and then I'd say Shanana. And something happened. I stopped thinking about tongues, and I just started being grateful and worshiping the Lord. And all of a sudden, my tongues doubled. And now I'm saying, Oshanana, Oshanana. Wait a minute, it just changed. And so I just kept praying, and I didn't have anyone to help me with this, but the more I was focusing on tongues, the harder it became. The more I was focusing on Jesus and how much he loved me and how much I loved him and how grateful, and I just started moving in gratitude. And all of a sudden I found myself, I wasn't even trying, I found myself saying, Oshanana, Oshanana. And all of a sudden I just realized I'm speaking in tongues. And it's real and it feels real and I'm not even thinking about it. It's coming out now and it's changed and I just felt so at peace. And that was like a long battle to get to that place. And so when I went back to my little Catholic meetings, 7 weeks, I'm probably on week 6 or something like that, and I could sing in tongues like everyone else. And that was a wonderful moment. They would sing in the Spirit and I could join in, and I wasn't in the group anymore that was praying for tongues. I was in the group that was, look, I want a prophecy. And they would lay hands on me and I'd wait and try to squeeze out something, think of something to say that would sound prophetic, and nothing was happening. And it was right around that time that, again, I was back and they prayed for me and a word came to my mind. And I said, I think I have a word. And they said, well, what is it? I said, I think the Lord said, my children, my people, I love you. And they said, is that it? And I said, yeah. And I mean, that was a lot. And they were kind of disappointed, you know, it really wasn't more than that. But I was glad I had a word and it was biblical. And so for me, it was a huge accomplishment. Now I'm speaking in tongues and prophesying. And so that's how I began this whole journey. It was, I wish there was a way to talk about it back then, or people around me that I could hear their story. Or when I realized that I had started speaking in tongues fluently, I realized some of those words had already been coming to my heart in my apartment, but I didn't have the courage to speak them out. But I think it all had happened there, but I just needed to put myself in a place of letting someone else pray for me. But anyway, that's my experience. So.